All right, 8 o'clock, yep. Time to start.
All right.
All right, welcome everyone to episode 2 of Let's Talk Swimming with the Fish. My name is Coach Nicole.
I'm Coach Matt.
And tonight we're gonna talk about backstroke. So just starting out with backstroke, both of us collegiate level backstrokers, pretty excited to talk about that tonight. I swim at George Mason, Coach Matt here swim at American University. And yeah, so we kind of know not only the technique behind backstroke, but also the difficulties of racing backstroke.
Definitely.
So to kick it off tonight, let's start by watching the 100 back final at Olympic trials that just happened this past week. This is Reagan Smith as she comes in, and just give us a chance to watch some really elite backstrokers in action.
Olivia Smolenka, maybe the slight favorite to get in there too.
First thing you really notice here is just look at the tempos that all of the swimmers across the entire race are holding. Pretty much you see similar techniques for all of them.
Attacking the turn and not slowing down into those turns.
The incredible underwater is coming up with that breakout and just.
And if you look all across the field, everybody's got a really still head, really still straight head.
Some fast backstroke.
So those are our two Olympians.
Yeah.
For 2021.
Pretty exciting. So once again, just kind of our overall goals for tonight, and just in general, when we're talking about racing, obviously our goal every time we hit the water is to get down the pool as fast as we can. And we're going to do that with using our energy efficiently, minimizing our resistance, and maximizing our power and our speed.
So just starting with some of these skills that we're looking for, what we're trying to identify as makes up a really great backstroke. So starting with the body position and the rotation. So thinking about where our head position is, and the head really leads the rest of the body. So whatever that head is gonna be doing, the body is gonna follow. And with that, keeping that head back and those hips up. And so if the head goes back, the hips automatically stay up at the surface. And as soon as that head comes up, the hips and the feet drop. Okay, and then we're also talking about their rotation there, the shoulders and the hips working together to rotate the body all as one piece.
We forgot to introduce Mr. Bendecki. If you weren't with us last week, this is our assistant, Mr. Bendecki, obviously named after Ray Bendecki, our CEO and founder. And so you might see him pop up from time to time to be a little visual aid. So after we discuss body position and rotation, we're going to talk a little bit about our entry, again, discussing the catch, which is that initial part of your stroke and your pull, the recovery, what your hands are doing, what your elbows are doing as your arms are out of the water.
Kicking and driving our kick from our hips and not being so knee dominant with our kicking. And then we had a couple bonus points talking about some breakouts and how to swim straight and manage that when you're swimming backstroke outside, and how to know where that wall is, both on the flip turns and on the finishes.
So starting with that body position and rotation, as Coach Matt mentioned, you know, our head position is gonna affect the rest of our body. So depending on where your head is, you know, if you think about your head, you don't want it too far back in backstroke where that water is gonna come up over the top. But also if you're looking down at your feet or trying to avoid looking at the sun, right, it's gonna force your hips to drop. It's gonna make it a lot harder to swim through the water. So the term that we like to say is that your head is resting on a thin pillow, right? So it's not quite all the way back, okay, but just very gently resting at the surface of the water. And then you're gonna wanna keep your hips up high in line with that head position. And you can see in this picture, this swimmer has really nice high hips in the water. Obviously the kick, your hips will move a little bit. They're not going to be totally stationary, but keeping them up, keeping everything nice and high.
You can even try it the next time you're at the pool. Just float on your back and then lift your head up and your chin down towards your chest and see what happens. Your hips and your feet will drop. And then go back to laying flat, you know, floating flat on your back again, and duck your head back and see what happens, and the rest of your body will follow down to the bottom of the pool. So it's something that you can even, you know, think about and practice yourself on your own next time you're at the pool.
So moving on to that rotation, right? Along with our, so along with our head staying nice and still through that rotation, right? If our head is moving from side to side or even tilting, it's gonna affect our ability to have that nice, clean, gentle rotation. Okay, your shoulders and your hips are gonna move together. And this rotation is also going to be driven by what your arms are doing. So your pull is going to be actually what is driving you to rotate. And then your legs are gonna assist you with that. So that kick should be nonstop the whole time through that pull and through your rotation onto your other side. Your body's gonna stay nice and long, okay? We don't want anything to be hips to drop, knees to start bending. We want to keep everything as long and as tall as possible.
Yep. And we want to make sure that we're balancing our rotation so that we're not rotating really far to one side and not quite so far to the other, or only to our left side and not at all to our right side. We want to have a nice balanced rotation with our hips and shoulders on each side of our body.
Moving in.
There was someone who had their Do we want to talk about putting their questions in the chat?
Oh, yes. So we did notice that there's some hand raising. If you want to go ahead and type your questions into the chat, we will have time at the end where we're going to go over all the questions. So if you think of something while we're discussing a certain point, just go ahead and type that on in there, and we'll discuss it a little bit more later.
Yep. We'll get back to you by the end of the lesson. Okay. So... before we even get into the catch, let's talk a little bit about the entry. So Nicole, what pink or finger do you want to enter the, I gave the rent.
Which pinky?
What finger do you want to have enter the water first in your backstroke?
I believe it's the pinky.
Your pinky. And you want that hand to slice in nice and easy, like a knife cutting through butter, right?
That's the idea, yeah.
And do we want to be over our head with our entry, way out wide with our entry? Where do we want our hands to go in when we're entering the water?
So we talk about, again, like thinking of our body as a clock. And if this is 12 o'clock, we're wanting to enter at about 11 and 1. So just wider than the shoulders, that pinky first entry is going to help you, like Coach Matt said, to really slice in to get into that stroke. For a lot of us, 11 and 1 feels really wide. Mm-hmm. Okay. So for those of you who are like, what can I do to fix my backstroke? Or you're kind of swaying from side to side a little bit, try widening out your stroke. It's going to feel like, if you are used to swimming right here and you're trying to get out here, it's going to feel like you're swimming in a T.
That's okay. Let it.
Let it feel a little weird at first. Yeah, let it feel weird so that your body can adjust to that change.
So once that hand has entered the water, that pinky is sliced down under the water, we've got our hand out of the water, our other shoulder is out, we've driven our shoulder out of the water with that rotation. We want that hand to go about 6 to 12 inches under the water with a nice, strong, firm hand and wrist. We want to really grab and manipulate that water with our hand and wrist. As soon as you get that hand to that right depth, you want to bend that elbow, get the fingertips to point towards the outside walls, So just like Mr. Bendecki over here, he's got one arm up in his recovery. He's ready to turn that hand over and enter pinky first. His head is nice and still and straight. His body is rotated slightly onto his side, and he's got his bottom arm down here in a really great catch position, ready to grab that water with his fingertips pointed to the outside.
So from that, right, we've bent our elbow, and now this is where we discussed that our pull is gonna drive that rotation, right? Because we don't wanna stay on our side until our hand is under our hip. As we are pulling, we're going to keep that wrist and hand nice and strong, like we're using a giant paddle with our whole forearm. We're going to follow that down all the way past our hips. As that's happening, your other arm should begin its entry, and you should be rotating onto your other side so that when you finish down past your hips, it helps you to drive that other hand in, start the catch with your next arm.
So a couple of ways to just simplify that. Some things that I like to tell my swimmers when we're working on our backstroke is that you want to make sure that you're pulling and rotating together, pulling and rotating together at the same time. Another one that we talk about is making sure that those hands are staying opposite of each other. So as one arm is driving into the water on that entry, the other arm is finishing past your hip and getting ready for that exit. So keeping your hands opposite from each other and making sure that you're pulling while you're rotating. Those are two ways to simplify and keep it nice and simple.
And Coach Matt, without cheating and looking on the PowerPoint, but which finger is gonna exit the water? If we're entering with our pinky, which one's gonna come out first?
That thumb is gonna slide out first. And again, eliminating all that drag, sliding that thumb right out with a nice knife-like hand. So we don't have any resistance at all. Hand slices right out with that thumb first.
All right, so recovery. We discussed a little bit, Coach Jeannie and I did in freestyle, that a lot of people, their recovery in freestyle, some of them will look a little bit different, and that's okay, that it's more important what's going under the water. In backstroke, it's more similar for everyone, right? Everyone wants that nice straight arm recovery. In backstroke, your thumb is gonna exit first, that arm is at full extension. So trying to make sure that we're not bending our arms and swimming like a G.I. Joe.
We're being floppy with our arms, right? Nice and straight, again, like she said, with your arms at full extension.
And then the other thing to note is that we're gonna follow with a straight line over our shoulders. So sometimes what we start to notice is people are swinging their arms either out to the side and kind of swimming like this here, or you're crossing back behind your body and crossing over that midline. So you wanna make sure that that arm is basically traveling right up over top of your shoulder. And then as you rotate that hand, when you get about halfway, that's going to help you to ease into that 11 o'clock and 1 o'clock entry.
So that thumb comes out, that thumb stays first until the arm gets to about the top of the arc. The hand turns over and gets ready for that 11 o'clock entry with that pinky in first.
Kicking, again, we're looking at a flutter kick here with backstroke. So once again, if you tune in last week, you heard this, that we kick from the hips, not from the knees, okay? Especially in backstroke, people tend to be working really hard to keep their hips up. And when you're moving your legs and trying to keep your hips up, it can be a little bit difficult. And what starts to happen is we're bending those knees down and kicking just with the bottom of our leg. So you wanna make sure your knee will bend slightly as you're driving that leg up, and then you are going to extend so that your toes flick the surface. Actually, this photo here does a really good job. You can see that the swimmer's foot had flicked the surface and is now driving back down with the whole leg as the other leg is starting to come up.
So when we talk about kicking from the hips and not the knees, that doesn't mean that you don't use your knees at all, right?
Right, no, for sure. You sorry. You need to bend your knee a little bit, one, because trying to kick your leg up with straight legs is just gonna be way too hard.
Right.
The resistance is just gonna be incredible. So again, we're looking at that efficiency and the efficient kick. So we want to make sure that we're doing things that are only going to help us move forward and not just make us tired.
Right. Would you say that you drive and start the kick from your hips and then you finish it and follow through?
Yeah, I think that's a beautiful way to describe it. You also want to make sure that those kicks, obviously, when we're learning that first motion, they're going to be a little bit longer and slower. But when we're talking about a racing kick, we want to make sure that those kicks are really short and fast, right?
Yeah, you barely want to be bigger than your kind of body line and the tube kind of that your imaginary tube that your body makes in the water. So you don't want to break that body line too much with a huge kick.
All right, so some challenges with backstroke and some common mistakes that we see. The challenges with backstroke are, we're gonna talk briefly about our breakouts, running into the lane line, which is especially hard right now when we're in the middle of the summer. You got the sun, you don't really have anything to follow. And then knowing how far away you are from the wall, right? Yeah. Where's the wall?
Yeah.
Common mistake's gonna be bouncing when you're watching someone swim and they're kind of bouncing up and down. That crossover with our arms, and once again, ineffective kicking. So we saw a really good example of this in that 100 backstroke final. The breakouts, everyone is in that extremely tight, super, super tight streamline through that dolphin kick. And then they get right up using the legs to help break them through the surface. They are trying to carry their speed as much as possible. You're doing all of this effort through your start, through your underwaters, whatever. You want to be able to get up and at full speed for your swim as efficiently and as, you know.
Yeah, so what you said I thought was perfect about they're trying to maintain their speed, right? Because you're never going to be moving as fast as you are when you come off the blocks or off the wall or off the start. So if that's your maximum speed, you want to carry that for as long, you know, as you can, ideally for the whole length.
Right.
And we saw a lot of great underwater kicking, but we saw no dead spots, right? We saw a lot of people going right from their dolphin kick, switching to their flutter kick.
Yep.
No dead spot there. And then from their flutter kick right into that first pull with their breakout, not being too early, breaking themselves out of their streamline and adding too much extra drag.
Right.
Right. But making sure that they've got it timed perfectly so that they hit that first stroke right as that arm is breaking the surface of the water.
And when they hit that first stroke, I mean, I noticed right away that no one looked like a narwhal, right? I don't know if you guys know. Yeah.
No one was coming way high out of the water.
And with that arm, a lot of times what we see is people coming off of their underwaters, they're starting to get that water up your nose because it is a challenge to, you know, figure out either how to hold your breath without getting water up your nose. And what happens is you start to lift that head and your arm comes up with you. Yeah. Now your arm is out of the water, that your back arm that needs to be starting your pull. So these two pictures do a really good job of showing as you're surfacing, right? Especially this second one here with this gentleman with the green goggles. And he has come up out of his streamline and now he tipped his head back. That little bit of tip is going to help him to get his whole body back up to the surface and start from that beautiful body position.
You can see his left arm here is ready to start that first catch and pull. And his right arm here is just breaking the surface of the water. So just like we were talking about earlier, keeping our hands opposite of each other, this one's about to start his pull and this one's just finishing that first pull, about to start his recovery.
We also want to make sure too that when we break out that we're only going to start with one arm. We're not going to bring both arms down by our side.
Good, good.
Coming out of that streamline, trying to keep our body as long and as tight as possible, just bringing that one arm down to get started. Yeah.
One other thing that you can notice by looking at these pictures on this slide is just the posture that everybody kind of breaks the surface with, right? So just like you were saying, keeping that body nice and straight, keeping that posture great and that angle nice and shallow as you come up and break the surface of the water.
Running into lane line. Okay. So, as we mentioned, you know, when you're swimming outside, it's pretty tough, to not run into the lane line. Yeah. Everyone has done it at least a few times, especially in practice when you're trying to stay on your side of the lane. But especially in a race, we don't want to be running into the lane line and zigzagging down the pool, hitting the lane line, bouncing off, and then trying to straighten ourselves out.
Right.
Inefficiency. So there's a couple of things that can cause you to run into the lane line besides the fact that you might not be able to see because of the sun. One of them is that your stroke itself is unbalanced. So when we talked about rotation, Coach Matt, you mentioned not rotating more to one side than the other. Right. So if your stroke is unbalanced, maybe your hand is entering too narrow on one side and that initial part of your stroke, instead of helping you get into your catch, it's pushing you sideways.
Right.
Maybe one side is stronger than the other. And so, you know, like if you were in a canoe, you rode on one side, you're going to slide sideways. Or it could also just be from your kick, that your kick isn't strong enough, or one leg is coming up higher than the other. And that unevenness is driving you to one side or one direction. Or moving your head. Right?
Yep.
If we're moving our head while we're trying to rotate,
the whole rest of your body is just going to fall and you're going to wiggle down the pool like a little snake, which we don't want. We want to be nice and straight, not nice, long, tight body line, rotating around our long axis, not wiggling down the pool.
So if you're inside, you can, you know, you can look at the ceiling. Hopefully there's some sort of straight line, or it's a little bit easier to tell if you're heading straight down the pool.
Right.
But when we're outside, we don't have that, right? There's no lines in the sky unless there's a plane, and that's not always going the same direction as you are. So when you're outside, you have to use your peripheral vision or that vision out to either side of you. You want to use it to stay near the lane line, close enough that you can see it, but not so close that you're going to run into it.
Yeah, that's a good tip.
So it obviously is going to help too to have some tinted goggles.
Definitely outside tinted goggles.
And they even make tinted goggles if you wear prescription goggles. Oh, awesome. Speedo has some, so you know, should be able to have some no matter what.
Yeah.
No matter what condition.
If you don't already have them, go pick yourself up a pair of tinted mirrored goggles for
yeah.
sure.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right, next challenge. You're swimming backstroke. You do not get to look where you're going, right? Because you're looking straight up at the sky or at the ceiling. So you are swimming at the wall blind, right? It's a blind approach, meaning you can't see the wall out in front of you. So how do we know where the wall is? Well, there's a special little thing that they made just for that purpose. And those are the backstroke flags. Right?
They're not just for decoration.
They're not. Although they do make the pools look good. but no, they are to help you make sure you know where the wall is and how far away you are from the wall. The flags are going to be the same distance at every NVSL pool that you swim at this summer. They'll be the same distance away from the wall, no matter what pool you're at this summer. So you can be confident knowing that, you know, your stroke count, once you perfect it, it's going to be the same at every meet you swim in this summer. So
that's going to be the most important part, right? To know that stroke count and to check in, you know, periodically as you get faster throughout the summer too. That's or true. As you get taller, your strokes are going to get a little bit longer. Maybe all of a sudden you realize you need to start kicking.
Yeah.
You're going to be going a lot faster. So you need to make sure that you practice that stroke count from the flags to the wall frequently throughout practice, and also whenever you can, practicing that at full speed.
Full speed is the key.
Okay,
full
because
speed is the key. That count is going to be different when you're going slow than when you're going at full speed, definitely. So you want to know what that count is when you're racing, when you're going at race speeds, so that you're not surprised when you flip over and the wall's right there in front of your face.
And when you have that stroke count and you've been practicing at full speed, we should be able to go into the wall really confident.
Mm-hmm.
Biggest thing that I see with new swimmers is we're coming in, we see the wall or the flags, and all of a sudden everything slows down and we count. We go 1, 2, 3, 4. So we want to make sure that we're able to do that stroke count at full speed consistently with the same number of strokes, and that we are going in with as much speed as possible, either for your finish or for your flip turn.
And just like we saw when we watched the women's 100 backstroke from Olympic trials last week at the beginning of the presentation, one of the things that I pointed out as the girls were swimming into the turn wall there was watch how they're attacking the walls, especially Reagan Smith, who ends up winning the race. She does a really good job in all of her backstroke races of if anything, she's picking up her tempo and
yeah.
accelerating into the wall and not slowing down. So
absolutely.
If anything, she's accelerating into the wall and increasing her tempo going into that turn.
So if I'm working on my stroke count and I'm like kind of between numbers, every time I try it, sometimes I'm 5, sometimes I'm 6. What should I do then? Should I go with 5 or should I go with 6?
Well, I think it depends on how close you are to the wall with 6 and how far away from the wall you are at 5. Remember that in your backstroke turns, once you turn over onto your stomach and you finish that freestyle pull, you have to be going right into your somersault and your
right.
tumble. So we don't want to stop with our hands at our hips and just glide, because that will be a DQ. So we don't want to do that. So if 5 is a little bit too far away from the wall and we're going to get DQ'd, we definitely want to go with 6.
Right.
And if 6 is maybe a little bit too close to the wall, like you're flipping over at 6 and your nose is almost touching, then maybe we'll want to go with 5. But if you're really in between, my advice would be to continue to practice it at race speeds and make sure that, you know, you're always practicing it at full speed to make sure you know what it's going to be. And as soon as you turn over, just keep that kick going all the way into that flip. Keep those legs firing off, even when you turn over onto your stomach.
And same with a finish, right? If I'm coming in and 6 is going to end up with me smashing my elbow into
right.
the wall, I mean, that's not a DQ, right? Your timer will stop at whatever hits the wall.
Right.
So whether that's, unfortunately, your arm, your fingertips, your head, that stops the clock. but we obviously want to finish with that arm extended. So if five is just enough that you feel like you're a little bit far, you're kind of between that half stroke, you can always just extend and keep that kick driving you to the wall.
Yeah.
Ideally, yeah. Ideally, if we're on the lower end of that stroke count too, we want to make sure that we're doing things to actively try to make our strokes faster and bigger so that that five is perfect.
Right.
And while we're on the topic of, oh no, I'm not quite to the wall, resist the urge to look, okay? If I'm here, I'm reaching for the painting, which is now my wall, and I look, a lot of times what's gonna happen is that shoulder is going to roll forward, I'm going to be past vertical, and that is going to be a DQ.
A lot of the other, some of the other issues I see when people start to, well, when people are just are not confident in their stroke count or not confident going into the wall, you see a lot of people starting to look around behind them, and then their hips and feet drop to the surf, to the bottom of the pool, and now they're basically swimming straight up and down.
Right.
Slowing themselves way down, adding extra strokes to their stroke count that is unnecessary and just going to mess up your count. So we want to be confident in our stroke count. We want to practice it a million times in practice so that we're really comfortable and confident. We can attack that wall. We want to make sure that we finish on a nice long stroke, whether it's into your finish or coming into your turn as well.
All right, so bouncing, like I said, a pretty common problem that we see, especially as people start to get tired, a lot of times you'll start to see them bounce up and down instead of having that really nice smooth stroke. And it once again, it could stem from a couple different things, right? One of them could be the catch and the pull. If you're not bending your arm on that catch, you're trying to keep that arm nice and straight, it's gonna put too much pressure under the water, it's gonna pop you up a little bit. Same with your pull, right? If you're not rotating as you're pulling, you're trying to pull straight down under your hip, it's going to pop you up. And now you have to force yourself onto your other side instead of staying nice and smooth. Go ahead.
So the other one that we see a lot that causes the bouncing is, I think, being too knee driven with your kick as well.
Yeah.
So we see swimmers who have a hard time driving that kick from their hips, like we talked about earlier, and following through with the knees, but making it too much knee, and that causes a lot of bounce for the swimmer as they go down the pool.
And then the other issue, I know we discussed this with already with running into the lane lines, but if that rotation is unbalanced, if you're only rotating to one side, you're not getting that other shoulder into the water, not driving that hand down, your hand is entering almost out to the side, you're gonna only really be on that one side, you're gonna have that gallopy kind of stroke.
Gallop, bouncy backstroke, so.
The crossover arms.
Yep.
This one's probably the hardest one to correct. Like I said, because you get so used to 11 and one feeling, this feels like 11 and one to a lot of people.
Right. But you're really 12 and 12.
And especially, with your hand behind your head, it feels wide, right? My arm is back behind my head. That's what you want, right? Well, not really. And a lot of times, if this is something that's going on with your stroke, getting your coach to videotape it or try to get that where you can see yourself straight on gives you a really good visual, like in these pictures where you can actually see that these swimmers' arms are entering behind their head instead of nice and wide in that 11 and 1.
Yeah.
So once again, the issue with this is not only that, you know, we're wasting energy. We're entering here. We're not going to start pulling powerfully until we get our arm out to here and can start that catch. So we're decreasing our efficiency, using some extra energy, and it can cause us to zigzag down the pool.
So I'm sure there are a few swimmers out there at least right now that are listening to this and thinking, oh yeah, I think that describes me a little bit. So what advice do you think, what kind of solutions have we tried that have worked in the past that have been able to help fixing this issue with the crossover on the arms, especially on the entry?
Great drill for this, double arm backstroke. Double arm backstroke, a lot of people use it as just kind of like a fun drill, do some breaststroke kick. But if you use it and actually follow your hands in the water, keep that nice flutter kick going so that it still relates to your backstroke, but you can actually watch your hands enter. Obviously, if you're using both arms at the same time too, and you normally bend your elbows a little bit, you're gonna feel those hands hit each other.
Yep.
So
that's a great drill for also self-correcting too, just being able to watch those hands go in. And then on the next stroke, if you notice that your hands were too narrow, set them out a little bit wider. If you notice that you didn't get your pinkies turned over all the way, like we discussed earlier,
right,
then make sure those hands get all the way turned over. Another one that I've seen Coach Ray use to help address this issue is he basically is having his swimmers trying to touch the surface of the water with their palm. So to turn their hand all the way over, and that gets them to be a lot wider outside. It's very hard to touch the water with your palm when you're in over your head. So just trying to touch that water first with that palm. I know that's not exactly what we talked about with our entry earlier, but just to correct this one specific issue, I've seen that work really well before.
And that's the thing with drills, right? That they're used to isolate a certain issue, and they might not be exactly how you want to swim, but it can help you to find an issue with your stroke and let your body feel that correction.
Definitely. Ineffective kicking. So backstroke, I think more than any other stroke, except for maybe breaststroke, is the most leg kick driven and intensive race ever. Yeah, I know when I used to swim, even the 50 back, and I would finish, my legs would just be totally shot. Yeah. You got to give it everything you got with that kick. So if your kick isn't as effective as possible, like we were talking about earlier, kicking from the hips and then finishing and following through with those knees and those quads, if it's not as effective, it's going to be a big waste of energy. It's going to slow you down. It's going to, you know, cause you to burn out a little bit too quickly, and you're going to fade at the end of those races. You're not going to have that kick speed that you want at the end of your 50 back. So, yeah.
Work on kicking. Work on kicking during practice, not just when it comes time to do a race, okay? Because that's what's going to help you to build up those muscles. Because kicking on your back, it works your legs a little bit differently, too, than being on your stomach.
Yeah, definitely.
So kick in all directions, on your side, on your back, on your stomach, everything you can to strengthen those legs.
I recommend doing as much backstroke kick for the backstrokers as you can, because not only is it a good way to help, you know, create an effective kick and help you learn how to drive the kick from your hips, but it also helps you, I think, get that body position right and figure out how to kick with your body staying right on the surface of the water, and I think that helps a lot, too.
Yeah. All right, so just kind of highlighting all the things that we roughly went over today, tips for swimming super fast backstroke, keeping that head back and your hips up, trying to stay as high in the water as you can, keeping your strokes nice and long and full with a fast tempo. So your stroke count is important. Now, that relates not only your stroke count from the flags to the wall, but the number of strokes that you're taking per length, right? We want to do the least amount of work and get the most amount of benefit.
Right.
Sometimes I say you want to be the laziest, fastest person in the pool. So less strokes, less energy expended, right? As much as you can out of each stroke. Keeping sight on that lane line, right? Using that peripheral vision and keeping that head nice and straight. So that's going to help you to stay to one side of your lane and not be bouncing from side to side.
Knowing your stroke count from the flags to the wall so you can attack that turn and attack that finish with confidence, just like Reagan Smith, and making sure that our turns and our finishes are the fastest, most aggressive parts of our race, because that's where you can definitely make up the most time.
Kicking, right? We just touched on it with ineffective kicking. We've been harping on it the whole time. Your legs are a huge source of speed and strength in your swimming, and it will help your arms to keep up that nice fast tempo if your legs are going fast as well.
Definitely. And not just the kicking while you're swimming, right? We saw in that first video, pretty much every girl going out as far as they could on their underwater dolphin kicks, which is a huge part of backstroke swimming now.
Absolutely.
And when we watch one of the men's races coming up at the end here too, you're going to notice the same thing. Almost all of the best swimmers are doing the maximum that they can on your underwaters.
Right.
So I know we were touching mostly on our backstroke technique, but man, that underwater dolphin kick is super important.
Yeah. And especially as you become more comfortable, get a lot stronger, adding those underwaters in is going to be what's going to help your backstroke get to the next level.
Definitely.
And another thing that you just have to do during practice.
Definitely.
You're not going to show up to the race and all of a sudden do 8 underwater dolphin kicks
and be the fastest one.
Wow, it's amazing. Yeah. So you got to practice it in your training and also slowly build yourself up to be able to see what your limit is.
Definitely.
We didn't have time to go over starts and turns today, but hopefully all of you are already ready to sign up to watch Coach Curtis's presentation on
starts and turns.
Starts and turns. Yep. On it's going to be the 5th and final of our Let's Talk Swimmings. That's going to be on Tuesday, July 13th.
Awesome.
So let's finish off.
Oh wait, one more thing.
Oh, I'm sorry.
We have one more tip that we need to give everybody today, don't we?
We do.
We do. Do you want to? Here's the tip. One more tip for everybody. You want to be thinking only during practice time. When you're in practice, think. Focus on your stroke. Focus on your kicking. Focus on your body position. Focus on your head position. Focus on your catch. Focus on your pull. Focus on your rotation. Listen to your coaches. But when you get up behind the blocks or behind the wall for that 50 backstroke on your at your Saturday meet or at your Monday meet or whatever, that brain should just turn off. And all you should be doing is going as fast as you can and just trusting all the work and the training and the time that you've put in to perfect all these little skills that we've gone over. So our last little bit of advice, non-backstroke related, but you know, kind of swimming related in general, do the thinking and the focusing during practice so that when you get up behind the blocks, you can just turn your brain off and race as fast as you can.
Don't think, just swim.
Don't think,
just right? Swim. Yep, just so let's watch Ryan Murphy not think and just swim in this 100 backstroke from Rio in 2016.
Let's look for all the things that we've discussed tonight. Underwaters, streamlines.
There's those streamlines and those underwaters right there.
Fantastic. Breakouts. Nice, clean switch to that flutter.
Heading right straight down the middle of their lane. Obviously, they're indoors. It's a little bit easier.
And look at all the heads. All the heads are perfectly still. Look at that.
In a middle position at the halfway
nice
turn.
Nice straight arms. Oh, that's a great one of being able to see that catch underwater. That one guy had kind of a wonky kick, though. That was strange. But most of them.
Exploding off that turn, attacking that wall with confidence. Being really great on those underwaters coming off that turn.
And you can see that their rotation isn't too much, right? It's just enough for them to be able to drive that hand down.
So we're not really talking about going 90 degrees from one side to the other, or even 45. I think most of the elite backstrokers are at about a 30 degree rotation.
51.97 seconds. Just outside the world incredible. Incredible.
Olympic record.
He's great. We'll definitely be cheering for him in Tokyo next month. So,
all right. So now I think we're going to turn it over to our questions. Let's see. Oh, no. There we go. All right. I got one here. Okay. So this one actually comes from a colleague of ours. Coach Matt, you coached two Olympic trial qualifiers in the backstroke events that just this past week. So what are some skills that they've mastered that have helped them to excel at that elite level?
So for those two guys, I've got two answers. The first is they're both really, really, really strong on their underwater dolphin kicks. JT and Sam both, I mean, JT's been doing it since he was little. We've been focusing on underwaters. Sam has gotten a lot better at them over the last couple of years. And so underwaters has been the biggest thing that they're both really, really strong in. And the other thing I think that they're really good at is the tempo. They're really consistent with that fast tempo, nice, big, long, straight arms. But if you watch them all the way down the pool, it's fast and it's consistent and it doesn't change from the first stroke to the last stroke. Every stroke is really fast, consistent, steady, strong.
And that's been an incredible thing to watch too throughout their careers as they've come up with us and continue to work with you, and just watching them be able to find those things and get bigger and stronger and better at them, doing them so consistently.
Yeah.
Okay, so we got one here. I know this was probably when we were talking about the flags and the count, that your pool is in yards, not meters. So that's always something that's good to check out. If you're swimming, training in a yards pool, then you're heading to a meters pool for your Saturday meet.
Definitely.
Find some time in your warm-up to double check, because it is going to be a little different.
So I should specify, the flags will be the same distance from the wall in every yards pool that you go to. And they will also be the same distance, although it will be slightly different, in every meters pool that you go to. So every yards pool, the flags will be the same distance from the wall, and every meters pool, the flags will be the same distance from the wall.
All right. What should I eat before a meet?
Oh, well, obviously you want to eat as healthy as possible, right? So we would say probably some lean protein, some healthy carbs, maybe like a pasta dish, some chicken breasts, some vegetables are always great. And making sure that you're, you know, fueling responsibly, especially on race day, because what you're putting into your body, you know, in the 20, 30 to 1 minutes to 1 hour before your race is also super important.
Yeah. And obviously, I mean, pasta and stuff, all of that is great during the day as well. But in the mornings, toast, eggs,
oatmeal
is a really good one.
Yep.
And trying out different things and what works for you, nothing too heavy that's going to upset your stomach. And just whatever you're eating, hopefully it's making you feel good. If you find that thing, you know, I was an oatmeal kid before I raced.
So I would get really nervous and my stomach would be in knots, like even the morning of a meet. So yogurt always helped me out the probiotics and everything, like just kind of calm my stomach down. We got one. What type of dry land exercises will help with the backstroke?
Okay. So obviously we focused a lot on keeping our hips up, and some of that comes from your head and your shoulders. But a lot of it is going to come from your core being nice and tight. Your core is going to help you to rotate your shoulders and your hips together. It's going to help everything stay nice and long. So any type of core exercise, you know, planks, sit-ups, crunches, even like back raises, you know, you want to be strong, not only in your abs on the front, but in your back muscles.
Lower back as well.
Obviously it's a kick driven event. So strengthening our legs with things like squats and lunges, and doing, you know, I discussed when we were kicking that kicking on your back works your muscles a little bit different, you know, doing lunges in different directions, lunging forward, lunging backwards, lunging to the side. So strengthening all around your legs and your core are going to be huge, and keeping your shoulders nice and loose. Okay. We don't want to do anything that's going to make our shoulders and our necks too tight. We want those muscles to stay nice and long.
Right.
And relaxed.
Question. Do you have any backstroke push-off tips? Yeah, definitely. So one thing that I see a lot with the push-offs that make them a lot weaker maybe than they could be is the angle of the hips and the knees and the ankles when they're set up on the wall right before they leave. So a lot of the times we have swimmers that open up those angles on those joints a little bit too much, and they're just not getting the strongest push-off that they can. When you're knee and your hip are at 120 degrees, you're not nearly as strong and powerful as when your knee and your hip joints are at 90 degrees. So just make sure you're set up on the wall properly, right? Hips, knees, ankles, all at 90 degrees, ready to explode through that wall. Making sure that back is nice and flat and straight, so that as you come off that wall and you extend through that line, your body creates a nice tight streamline, right?
And when you plant your feet, if you're going in from a turn, or even when you're starting your start, you don't want those feet glued together.
We don't want them glued together, and we also don't want them too far apart, right? So if your feet are too far apart, your knees are going to kind of be buckled in, and your feet are going to be all weird. And if we're too close together, we're just not going to have the power and the strength.
Right. Just like if you were trying to jump straight up in the air.
Exactly.
If you know, you need to test how far apart you want your feet. Try to jump straight up in the air as high as you can. See about where your feet are landing and where you're leaving from. Absolutely. That should be about the same.
Yep.
All right. Do we have any more questions coming
more
in?
Questions?
Oh, maybe in our, what foods can we bring to meets? So quick carbs, things like granola bars are really good. Especially like the chewy granola bars, because they're easy to break apart. That way you can have a little piece of something to get something in your stomach. Chocolate milk is phenomenal for recovery.
Recovery drink, yep.
I would say things like bananas and again, just-
Yeah, fruit is great.
Yeah. The biggest thing that we don't want to be eating during meets is just junk food, right? Junk food isn't going to make you feel good. It's not, well, it feels good at the time when you're trying it, but unfortunately it's not going to
help you perform well. It's not going to sit well on your stomach when you're trying to perform at your best.
Right? Once you're done, go crazy. Eat the donut, eat 5 donuts. Okay. Go for it. But before race time,
during the meet, keep it healthy.
And hydrate.
Yeah.
Hydrate as well.
You know, just think about the foods that you're putting into your body is the fuel that you're going to use. So especially leading into and on race day, you want to be fueling that, you know, your body, your machine as well as possible. So
absolutely. Are Gatorade energy gummies good to eat before a race? So they're good. I mean,
they're not bad.
They're mostly, you know, sugar. They're that quick source of energy. So especially if you have events that are pretty close back to back, or maybe you're someone who can't eat a lot in the middle of the day because your stomach gets too upset. If you can get one of those down, it will give you a little bit of a burst.
And there's all sorts of products like that. They have the, you know, the goo gels or, you know, any other kind of energy gel or gummy or bar, or I think they even make maybe jelly beans now.
Yeah. Oh, sport beans. Yep, for sure.
Stuff. like that that's out there. Yeah.
Is drinking too much water between races bad?
Well, you probably just don't want to feel full and like you have a bunch of water sloshing around, but you definitely want to stay hydrated and keep your body, you know. Yeah.
We want to be sipping water frequently.
Right.
Because especially at these summer meets, it's very hot out. And especially if you're swimming later on during the day, it's just going to continue to get hotter and hotter. Your body needs water for every single thing it does. Yeah. Your cells need water. So staying hydrated is super important. But yeah, I mean, just feeling that that you don't want to feel bloated and too full. Cadence counts to help with keeping consistent strokes.
So if you have the opportunity to use or be exposed to a tempo trainer, which we have some of at our team, that's a good way of just working individually with your coach to find out what tempo is right for you.
Right.
Because it's going to be different for every person. So we were talking about the two Olympic trial guys earlier. So one of them is like 6'5", and his stroke rate is a little bit lower, slower. And the other one is about 6 feet tall. And so his stroke rate is a lot faster. So everyone's going to be a little different. But if you have the chance to work with a tempo trainer, you just kind of put it in your cap right next to your ear, and it just kind of beeps every time one of your arms is meant to be going in the water. So that's a good little tool to help learn how to be consistent and how to, you know, keep that tempo nice and steady.
Depending on how musically inclined you are, if you don't have a tempo trainer, find yourself a nice upbeat song.
Yeah.
Use that to kind of, you know, most of us sing when we're swimming anyway, because there's a lot to be
doing
while we're swimming. So a lot of times you kind of have a song stuck in your head anyway. I wouldn't suggest like a nice slow song, but finding something that's upbeat is going to help you to find that tempo too. Just like they say, staying alive for doing CPR.
Yeah, yeah.
It could probably work for your backstroke too. Like, I like that one.
All right.
So I think that is probably going to wrap up our questions. So thank you again so much for joining us. Hopefully you enjoyed our time together. You learned something. Tune in next week for Breaststroke with Coach Kim and Coach Curtis. If you missed our freestyle one last week, you can go ahead and head to our YouTube channel. It's the Fish Swim Team on YouTube. And we just posted that freestyle episode from last week.
Awesome.
And you'll be able to catch this one again next week, right before Breaststroke comes out.
Cool.
And if any of you are looking to swim year round, or maybe,
or you have friends who are looking to swim year round.
Very true. You can head on over to pevfish.org. That is, we are the fish. And we would love to see you not only next week on Let's Talk Swimming, but also in the pool with us.
So once again, I'm Coach Matt.
I'm Coach Nicole.
Thanks for joining us.